And hello, hello, hello again, ladies and gentlemen. It's your host, Marley Startled, and we're going to be continuing on. We start in the Confederate campaign after the disastrous attempt in the latest patch. I have been checking on Steam, and apparently the latest patch, the Union has become on steroids with massive armies, so it's actually going to be a lot harder to win. But that is good. We want that sort of historical accuracy, and we're going to see if we can this time power game, so no rules apart from the no raiding, because raiding's OP. We're going to go straight in and be as aggressive as possible. Sadly, no campaign in Missouri, because don't want Missouri, the state guard, to delete again, so Missouri is immediately going to be abandoned, but we are going to change our strategy. So, as you saw in the previous campaign, or the disaster campaign, I don't think European intervention is going to work. He's going to run out of time. So we're going to pick the OP policies for the Confederacy. And then the aim here will be to be aggressive. As I saw once Lee moved into Washington, how the Union this sort of beeline towards the capital. So what I'm thinking is if we go aggressive, we can hopefully curb the Union's aggressive expansion. And we'll just try to attempt to hold Kentucky and Virginia. So we are going to play it a bit more normally. So we know arms agents, of course, get extra arms at the start. Industrialization, get extra industrialization policies. And the Southern Pacific Railroad, which will give us an extra credit rating, more rail transport, and quicker construction speed. This will be no European intervention, and it means that Virginia will have lower support. But it will, should mean that we should start on a more equal playing field with the Union Army. So let's find out. Yeah, so it appears there's a few bugs for the latest patch. The first bug is, of course, the raiding now being broken. The disappearing Missouri State Guard, and also the OP Union size. Well, it's not OP, it's historically accurate Union blobs, which now come up the wall. Also, it looks like weapon reduction has been changed a little bit now. There's some theories being that the more supply depots you have, the more your guns are going into the supply depots and not going into reserve. That may be a problem. However, this could work in our favor if we just capture Union supply depots, so we can effectively just feed our forces that way. So this way, this strategy, we're going to go immediately militia act, 5 speed, abandon Missouri, focus all on Kentucky. So we have 2 armies in the Kentucky area. We shall see. Yeah, sorry, Missouri, you're going to go. You're going to be a Union state, Missouri. I'm not playing that game again. So some people believe that the reason why the Missouri State Guard is disappearing is that if they get too close to a river after a battle, they get deleted because they become in the river. And so you've got to be careful about having the Missouri State Guard too close to this river area. So we're not going to go anywhere near that. Instead, we'll probably withdraw them down to here and have 1 army moving to Kentucky and 1 army being reserved over here. But still, this railroad should provide us quicker maneuverability now, and the extra gun should hopefully work in our favor as well. So immediately, recruitment, trade war, industries up. Let's bump everything up to the max. That's going to take me 25 days. We won't need military 2 yet because we haven't got all the militia access yet. And there's a little Fort Sumter over here for you. Look at there's 40 Sumter. So we're going to play aggressive as per usual, move into Washington. That should hopefully attract Union attention. And we'll have to micro as well here, because the sizes of the armies are pretty bruh right now. I wonder what Nebraska was doing during this this period. I suppose Indian Territory was this Indian Territory, so you're like Custer and that after the war. So, you think one thing you can't mock is just the whole map design, and they really have been quite lovingly with the been quite loving with the design of the map, and just the general presentation of the game. It could have been very easy if someone drew a bog standard map, but they haven't. They've really been good at making it very setting-esque. We are probably going to build forts as well, but let's see. Okay, industrialization policy 1 selected. I can go to military 2. I'll do military 1. Should eventually also hit, whoa, you've changed again. Oh, automatic, yes, turn that off. That'll be why. Very high, very high, very high, very high, very high. Two policies, yes, that's good. So you can see my state support starts a little bit, my national morale starts a little bit lower. It's a little bit lower, these policies. But in terms of equipment, we're going to have a lot of equipment stolen from the Union. No. I wish there was a way I could create a speech chat to ban those bots that always come on. I wonder how much actually business they get from getting fake viewers. He's like a bit of a waste of money. I just like get my iPad on, like, yeah, okay, that's one viewer. Get my iPhone on, there you go, that's another viewer. You know, it seems a bit bruh to even pay money for that sort of service. I'm going to say something very toxic and use the internet clout I get to get boosted up to the big leagues. First things first, save the game. Let's delete all these saves. I save the game. Next. Move Missouri State Guard down to Memphis. Move them down here. Second thing, second. Start building supply depots. Depot. Don't know why that's Union. I'll try not to think about it too much. I guess it's because it's recently flipped. And upgrade this supply depot here. Or not. Is that gonna flip? Has everywhere else flipped? Yes, it has. Okay. Okay, and now armies. So the Militia State Guard, immediately transfer this to the Army of the Potomac. No. Army of Tennessee gets to stay, Army of Shenandoah gets to stay, Western Army gets to stay, Army of Northwest can move over here as well. Good, transfer. So these no longer exist. Western Army can wait for a bit. First things first, we need to work on the Army of the Potomac and get it up to standard. So again, I'm thinking a nice, cool 30,000 men. So put three cannons in here. What sort of guns do we have? Lovely stuff. That's the sort of thing I'm looking for. 54 muskets. Yeah, that's the sort of arms I'm looking for. Four of these bad boys. That should bring me up to 18,000. Give me a cav measurement. One, two, three, four. What sort of equipment can we get from you? Oh, lovely stuff. That brings me up to a 28,000, and we'll add another four. And that leaves us with a silky 40,000 army, and of course, Lee's going to take the Army of the Potomac. Max upgrade this, because it's going to be our aggressive arm at the start of the war. But with very good weapons, because of the bonuses we pick at the start of the game. Army of Shenandoah is going to become a... army as well. 1, 2, 3, 4. See if I can find that Palmerston again. Is it Palmerston or Palmerton? Joseph E. Palmer. Got a name. It was John, wasn't it? John. Dear John. Turn this off, turn this off, turn this off. Just be an arty boy, isn't it? John, John, John. There it is, John Pelham. That's the man we're looking for. Turn this off. Make sure we fix this so we don't lose all our officers and can't find them. Army of Potomac, of course, I know what I need to replace him with. Bug here. Seems like there's a UI bug where troop replacement breaks you get officer selection breaks your game. So we have to exit out now. This is a new bug that's coming with the patch as well. So for all you stalker LARPers, look forward for an extra 15 minutes or so of picking the boys. And back in. There's a 40,000 army. I'll replace Jackson with someone else for now. And then Jackson can come over here. There you are, Jackson. turn this off. And I might turn off forts as well. Here we are. This is how I got my armies instead. Lord of State Militia, you're going to be transferred to the Army of Shenandoah. Hampton Division, you can stay about that size. You're just going to be the garrison unit. Army of Shenandoah. All of those boys. And then Cav. Oh, I don't want that. No, 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 that's too much arty for me. You could probably cheese this game, I reckon, and just have a massive artillery army, but I don't think it would it'd be very fun. Because you get a lot of artillery equipment, and the arty don't take up a lot of space, so you could have a big artillery arm. I quite like just having a limited amount of artillery, like 295 boys. How many guns? 20 guns? I don't know. 20 guns right now, will be more later, don't we? 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, that's us out of men. Let's upgrade. And don't worry, as soon as we go to army 2, we'll be fine. Yep, I'm trying to get you guys to leave. As soon as you're ready to leave, you can get out. You need to stop starving. Bow, 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 bow. Yep, this time we're going hard on the LARP. I expect to win this now. How are you big already? How are you so big already? That's what makes me mad. I haven't even built my force yet and already you're a big boy. Not the Army of Shendo, is it? Apparently it is. Still not enough men. The job I have planned. One invasion so far, but as soon as I take Washington, we'll have these boys on the run. Let's gotta get this. Let's gotta get the boys together for the attack. You fellows should be almost on your way out. I know you're low on supply, but once you get here, you'll be fine. Men versus 10,000. Too early days yet. I want to wait until I've got my resources up. Not Wilmington. Don't blockade me, please. Where's the invasion at? Still just one army there. Why 2,000? Still not enough boys for the job this year. 18,000, almost there. Come on, give me more men. Manpower's pretty tight at the moment. We'll be able to get that sorted though. As soon as we rush down conscription, we'll be fine. We're going down Militia Act right now. Or we probably should be going down Conscription after this. 18,000 versus the 2,000 I still have here. Ugh. 21,000 versus 10,000. All right, we're good. This is a time for an aggressive act. 20,000 versus 6,000. No, 10,000. We can move forward. It means a lot of our force will be under strength, but we gotta go aggressive. There we are. So they're 10,000 versus my 27,000, but again, the tables will turn very quickly. But I want to be aggressive. I know what's coming. So we're going to be as aggressive as hell. On the east, so they stop getting attracted to the west. I do like, depending on what officers you pick as your leader, you can you have different quotes. For example, if you picked Lee in your army, Lee will have, as a leader, Lee will have like quotes in the loading screen. I don't think it's for every officer. It's more like the historical notable ones, but I do like that mechanic. So you get that extra bit of a bit of history about each individual. So on the left, we have Jackson in charge of the cavalry for some reason. Okay, Jackson's now a cavalry commander, and we have Buckner and Frost, and as for cavalry artillery, we have Johnston for this army. The objectives appear to be all around the center, and it looks like a straight road down to Washington, so our engagement will be a pretty obvious, clear-cut fight the battle, hope to win. Then we take Washington, and then they all come to us, and this all blows over. Imagine if you could just win the game just by taking Washington like in the first month of the war. Like, you've won the game. So a lot of these troops will be undermanned. Oh no, I zoomed out. I couldn't get that sweet music in. But with the focuses I picked at the start, it gives us a lot more leeway early game to match the Union. Where's my last boy? Who's late? Who's late to the party? Which one of you's late? Got my eye on you. Suppose we'll have to move forward soon. I do tend to move forward in steps. I won't try and like tell the army to move all the way over here initially. Even if I do want to go over here, I'll tell them to move forward in steps, so that way if they do have an early engagement, there's a higher likelihood that my army is more formed up than the Union force. So I'll form up about here as a stopping off point, then I'll advance them forward a bit more, and then I'll advance them forward a bit more. Jackson's happy. Normally, if you don't have Jackson as a core commander, at the very least, he'll always be an unhappy boy doing his own thing. Now I've sent another step, another leapfrog to forwards. I think I could probably get away with a no micro Union run, but I don't think with this current patch, there we go, I can do a no micro Confederacy run. I think I would break down doing it. So immediately tell everyone to engage at long range. Whoa, I've left an entire force back at spawn. This has already gone off to a good start. Because they are all, because they're all under General Lee directly, which is a bit of a mistake there. Didn't do a very good job organizing my army. I'll have to fix that after I win this battle. Still, not the end of the world. There we go, maximum cheese. Maximum cheese. Don't worry, guys, I'm just reforming in front of you. Don't fire, teehee. See how well this works out for you. I'm sweeping in. What are you doing, Lee? Oh, Lee's like right behind the front line. Come on, get me a bit closer. Yeah, a lot of undersized horses, but nothing I can't handle. Cheat him. Cheat him by name, cheat him by nature. Dismounted cav charging is not a good idea. Goodbye, US cavalry. Council of the order. Keep advancing. As you can clearly see, dismounted cav for point blank range is not a good idea. I do like the northern, eastern campaign maps. They're very open, very flat lanes, good for manoeuvring. What sort of equipment these guys got? Springfield rifles, muskets, lovely stuff. Again, you only really get this sort of stuff if you do the arms agents and the industrial focuses. Otherwise, the best you're going to get are Springfields and mixed muskets with the Confederacy. Unless you can steal some from Union supply depots. So this is like alt history. What if the Confederacy had an economy? Clear victory here. Always is if you want to game hard. It's always good to go on an early offensive, especially as Confederacy, because that's when the numbers are still pretty even and you'll be able to get numerical superiority. I remember playthroughs where I, before the readiness and the supply mechanic, where I just run up all the way to Washington, up to New York, and just raid over there and take all that territory, and that would normally just kick the Union out in terms of industry for a very long time, buying you the time you needed to win the war. But sadly, with the new readiness mechanics, it's a lot harder to do so. Dr. Jones, I remember you, a good friend of mine, Dr. Jones. Seen you in many a battle. Have a good old fashioned case of the general route. How's my cab doing? Decided to move yet. We've got one on the move. Got two on the move, but they're taking their sweet, sweet time. Where are we going, Jackson? Don't worry, I got a plan. Okay, Dr. Jones, let's see how well you do. Normally you don't let the team down, Dr. Jones. Normally you're pretty good at your job. Yeah, I can always depend on Dr. Jones. And I know it's not Dr. Jones. I know. I just like to call him that. It's an affectionate name. There you go. Easy victory. Watch them all run. Oh, there's a cap. I wonder would you show up. What do you want to go for, cap? We can try and sweep in over here. And who's leading my cow? Braxton Bragg, eh? I don't think you're a cavalry officer, Braxton, but I can live with it. Lucky boys, we got halted by one Union force holding the rear guard. Not the end of the world. Good charge here. A bit of chaos here because the envelopment has begun. Beaten by name. And the withers. I don't think I'm going to get a surrender in time. Still. Some heavy casualties were inflicted. Well, actually, not very heavy at all. Only 3,600 from the Union side. Interesting. So, a lot of people, a few people, I reckon, if they bought this game now, would be a bit unhappy with the constant weird bugs that appear in each patch, but. For me, it's kept the longevity of the game going because each time I play it, there's like mutations of the game. So I've got to play it slightly differently with variations. Because otherwise, I'd just be doing the same thing on repeat over and over. Like, okay, let's take Missouri. Okay, let's move into Kentucky. Whereas but now I can't take Missouri. I've got to abandon Missouri because of a bug. And because of the Union hordes now, I've got to play around a bit more, being more aggressive. Now I wish to Washington. That Washington should become mine soon. Rebels on the move. Build me a supply depot. Come on. Apply. Apply, please. I can't unclick it. Okay, now I can. I don't want you to do that. Cancel your order. No. No. No, Lee, no. Oh, you know what, Lee? No, I can't stay mad at you. So, first victory. Badly know Washington yet, but I think it has made some of the Union Army recoil, so I'll wait until I get to a higher readiness. I'll upgrade this so I get my supply back. We're going to rush down Military Act 2 and then Military Act and Conscription to get more manpower. Army of Shenandoah, I know what I want from you. Give it to me. Good enough. How are we doing on... Yeah, we got guns for days. We're fine. Okay, Price has reached its destination. Let's go and take a look. I'm going to make you build a supply depot here, Price. Or not, because you've got no readiness. Thankfully, you're in friendly territory, so... and you're on a railroad as well, so your supply shouldn't be that bad. I'm going to wait till green readiness this time, so once I take somewhere, I can actually move on for the offensive. Conscription, and then we're going to go with, oh, thank you, shell upload, for the follow, but yeah, conscription, and then we're going to go, economy, you print the money, and then industry, but actually, I may do industry first. Upgrade. How many more men can I field? Oh, that's a lovely amount of men I can field. Big armies for the east, that's the plan. Small armies for the west. I'm going to try and make sure they obsess around Washington. Okay, 40,000 ain't too bad. Then the next is the Western Army. So we're going to transfer some troops from the Missouri State Guard to the Western Army. So they're about 20,000 strong, because that will be our main army. Then once we get more manpower, we'll hit out the defensive army of the Missouri State Guard. Okay. Give me three of these bad boys. Give me three. Three for me, thank you. Lovely stuff. Four for you. Nice, nice, nice. Upgrade. And that'll give me about 16,000 men, so we'll do one more cavalry force. Well, you know my build by now. Don't really vary it that much. I always try and build early so I don't get sucked into the vicious core system, which I hate doing. Cores are just a nuisance of micro. So once the Western Army is nice and big, we will begin to move into Kentucky. I was saying that we could probably move in now. Wait for our manpower to steadily come back. Why not? And then the army to Potomac. This was the bug. This was the problem. I had all these guys under Lee directly. Good if you want sort of like a grand reserve, but not too good if you want a fighting force. Any of you boys green yet? Nope. Pretty even on the forces. Western Army. Can I make you any bigger? I want at least 40,000 for the Western Army as well. I know I said I just like having even forces, if you know what I mean. Okay, now we're slowly running out of the good stuff. All we got left is Springfields and mixed muskets. Still, 42 Springfields ain't bad. Three State Guard. You're going to be our reserve force. Make sure no one comes up behind us or into any of our states. You're going to be whack-a-moling any enemies that come into our territory. Ah, but you ran out. Good. Or bad. Depending on how you look at it. Don't be starving anymore. Hello again, Dor. Welcome back. Watching Confederate Attempt 2. Cheese the game, Boogaloo. Sadly, no Missouri campaign this time because I'm a bit traumatized after living those 50,000 soldiers. Felt bad, man. Felt bad. So, this is 41,000 men. This is 8,000 men. And this is 10,000 men. That's the tile for you two. I called it absolute disaster. Operation Cheeseboo. Yeah. Operation Shyhard. Confederate Attempt 2. Problem is, because the title of the game is so long, I've got such a limited amount of things I can say after it. So I can only like have three words. Okay. McClellan has decided to... have his own 30,000 force, so we're retreating really down to Nashville. Oh, where's the Army of the West then? Where's the Western Army? Where is my Western Army? Okay, so the Army of the Tennessee is the wrong army. That's probably why we're having such a problem there. Yeah, the Army of Tennessee can run away. Probably, preferably the right way, if I'm honest. I don't want you running towards the enemy. What are you doing, Zolly Coffer? Oh no, not again. Yeah. So, so this is the 30,000 army. It's all the way over here. I've got to move it. Well, I can cheese. We can cheese if I get this guy back. But yeah, that's another bug. You can't withdraw your army. Sometimes they'll withdraw into enemy territory. Like, ah, see, like right now I can't withdraw this force. It keeps on getting scared away in the wrong direction. Yeah, what are you doing, Step Army? Alright, go this way. It's not too bad. The Western Army should get there in time to put McClellan in his place. He says... Plus, these guys are green to go now, so immediately go on the offensive. Get me Washington, boys. Sweet, sweet bureaucracy. Oh no. What a shame. Build me a depot. We're going to be needing it. If you can, boys. Build me a depot. Letting a team down early. And the unions are already at it again, but I can win this. They really are. They do grow very quickly. Very quickly indeed in this game. The union, like, normally it takes a while for the Confederacy to build up, but these union boys, they're getting big quite quickly. What? What are you doing, Step Army? My accent, civilized accent, that's what it is. God tier British accent. Alright, where are they coming from? We're going to go immediately on the offensive as per usual. Yeah, your American English. Got some fries in the trunk of the vehicle. I don't mean that, boys. I don't mean it. Don't bully. I'm just upset because we're no longer a superpower. Yeet. No, I don't. I swear. I promise. No longer superpower. It was bad, man. Welcome back, Hoffman. We're secretly a space, a spacefaring nation, but we don't want to admit it in case you boys decide to nuke us. We, in fact, discovered teleportation about, like, 10 years ago. You know all those flying saucers? They're actually flying teacups. Because we want to keep all the space tea to ourselves and the space sugar. Yeah, let's be honest. If you want an evil spacefaring nation, you've got to have a British accented evil speaking nation, space nation. If it's not, it's just not the same, you know. Same. I mean, I wouldn't mind America being a spacefaring empire, but I just wouldn't. Wouldn't just have the same sort of evil undertones as a British accented one. No. Oh no, the Glibglobians are revolting. Time for another purge, I see. It's just like, we come to liberate your ass. Is that space oil? Juarez, get the MG. Space bread and space sausage. Oh no, we're not letting the Germans into space. Okay, so that's a recipe for disaster. It's gonna be kill zone but with German with the Hellgast, like, immediately. Literally the Hellgast. No, as soon as the Germans get to space, we're gonna have a bad time. Yeah, we like world wars, but what about space wars? Oh, you're French, you're not even German. Oh no, you are German, sorry. You are German, Hoffman, you are. I thought you were French. I think because it was the previous playthrough. Yeah, if every major nation, like planet Russia, this vodka. That's a good idea for a game. Like every nation has its own planet, and their ideology is like ramped up to 700. So like America's is like Ancapistan like times 200. Oh yeah, okay, a frog. What's the sausage? Why do you want sausage then? That's a German thing. Or season. It's bread, I can understand. Bread, yes. Pan. Trattoria. Yeah, I don't mind a bit of pan. I actually quite like a French continental breakfast. It's actually rather light on the stomach. You know, like English breakfasts are just really unhealthy. So you've got your beans, your fried bread, your sausages, your tomato. It's just like a heart attack rolled into one starting breakfast. Whereas a French one, you've got your French bread, your ham or your jambon. Your little boat cakes you get. Oh, that's much lighter on the palate. Much lighter on the palate indeed. So what am I actually doing here? What's the plan? I'm too busy talking about continental breakfast. I like the little boat cakes the French have. And also they have these really nice chocolate biscuits. It's like a smiley face on it, and it's like it's a wafer with chocolate in the middle. Yeah, there's a French film, I think it's a comedy about this like this government worker in France, and he gets posted up to the north. And everyone's like, and he's like, really, and he thinks it's like the end of the world, and it's awful, and it's a nightmare, and his like wife's crying because of it, because you know, down south it's all sun, relaxed and chill, and in the north it's just cold and wintry and bureaucratic. I forgot what the name of the film is called. But then he gets up there and he finds out it's not that bad, and he keeps on telling his wife it's awful. So his wife decides to give him a surprise visit, so he has to tell all his northern friends to pretend it's really bad. And eventually she finds out, and it's a happy ending, but you know, it's a good comedy. I don't remember the name. I don't remember the name. I think my old man watched it because he found it hilarious. I found it quite funny as well, and even I don't speak French because it is a meme. Like, you can see that in every nation with like every country of like a variable climate. If it's like a cold north and a chilled south, or the south, the Mediterranean south, like in Italy, everyone's chilled out, relaxed, not a lot gets done. But then when you go up north, it's like, okay, industry, bureaucracy, but productivity. And then, of course, everyone says, "Oh, look at Spain," or "Look at, yeah, like look at Spain. It's so poor. It's got low GDP." Yeah, but they don't work like 24 hours a day for 7 days a week in some pod, you know. They actually have some time to go to the sea. I do like other countries' stereotypes. Where are you going, Cav? It's like for us in the British, our stereotype is that if like the South is all educated and civilized and it's all very metropolitan, and the further north you go, the more backwards the places. So like when you get up to like Manchester, there's the stereotype is they're all drunken sausage roll loving savages that don't enjoy civilized food or holidays, who are obsessed with football teams. What's it called, like North FC, the North FC meme. Hopefully I'm not dropping the stream. Am I dropping? I don't think so. I think it's just my iPad deciding to do itself. I mean, I went to Paris, and some of it's nice. Like, we went to the French Museum with, like, Napoleon's coffin in it. But a lot of it is not so nice. Like underneath every bridge is, like, a vagrant camp, you know? It's not really a museum, fair one. And I went to Notre Dame as well before it burnt down. I never saw the Mona Lisa, sadly. This cavalry needs to go, like, now. Had to push through a bunch of Asian people to view it, and it was not worth it. I mean, I've never seen a Mona Lisa, but it's just one of those iconic art pieces, you know? I just like the fact it's in a public gallery and it's not in some rich guy's basement. Interesting strategy from the AI. They've done two-line track, so two-line blocking the advance here, and one-line halting the advance here. In all fairness, I do like French history. I like French culture as well. Very chilled out. I like how they eat their food and they drink. The English are binge drinkers. Like, we just drink and we don't eat as well. So when we go out for a night out, we'll just drink and drink and drink. We won't eat anything, or we'll eat, like, a kebab afterwards. Whereas the French, you know, they'll drink throughout the day, but they'll have food with it, and they'll have, like, wine with it, and they'll drink a lot, but they'll drink a little throughout the day, if you know what I mean. They won't just, like, have two pints of Strongbow. They'll have, like, a glass of wine here, a glass of wine there. The educated way of alcoholism. Whereas the English, especially the young, they'll do their free drinking first, so they'll go to, like, a corner shop, and they'll get, like, two bottles of vodka, drink down that, then they'll go to a nightclub, then just drink for like, the entire night, and then after throwing up or passing out, they'll go and have a kebab. It's very uncivilized. Yeah. Yeah, and that's one thing I will say. You French don't pick up after your dog. Like, especially when I've gone to Calais and that, there is there's just dog, there's dog feces everywhere. Like, you don't pick up after your dogs. It's like, ah, there's some dog shit. There's some dog shit. There's some dog shit. A lot of French poodles, but I don't mind them. There's actually good fighting dogs. Used in wars. I think poodles get a bad rep because they look very effeminate. Actually, if you, like, you know, they were used in actual military engagements. I think they've got, like, a very strong bite. But you wouldn't think it if you saw a poodle. You'd be thinking, oh, it's a poodle, you know, it's a designer. It's like a chihuahua. But it's not. A poodle, like, it's got a hell of a bite. They're going to try and charge into this wood line here, or into this fence line to get some cover. I think my favourite period of history is the Napoleonic Wars, because it's almost like out of a fairy tale book. Like, it's almost like You know how Alexander the Great is so old in history that it's almost mythological, you don't really believe it. But the Napoleonic Wars and Napoleon is so recent that it's still believable and it's still relatable. And it's just like something out of a book, just like Napoleon constantly winning against these insane odds over and over and over. And then eventually doing something impossible and failing and then coming back for one last hurrah. Yeah. Favourite period of history. Yeah, favourite period of history is the Napoleonic Wars. Yeah, Napoleon was a big old propagandist. Like, again, one of his more intelligent things is he understood the importance of propaganda. Though he did a lot of intelligent things, but yeah, he commissioned so much artwork, he funded so much artwork, he had his own newspaper, he had the journal for the Army of Italy. Yeah, he knew how to spin. Like, Napoleon knew how to create an image of himself. Oh, the English, yeah. The English really big up the Peninsula War and everything like that, but you gotta remember, what was Napoleon doing during the Peninsula War? You know, he was doing a lot of stuff. He was, like, not really paying much attention to what was going on in Spain. But we helped. I mean, we put millions, or like what into what in today's money is like trillions, into paying other people to fight the war for us. You know, the only way Napoleon could fund his wars was because we kept on giving money to his enemies, who we kept on beating and taking the money off them. Like, we'd go up to, like, Austria and say, "Hey, Austria, want to go to war with Napoleon?" It's like, "I'm not too sure about this, bro. We've already lost against this guy, like, three times. What if I gave you £2 million? I'm not sure. What about £4 million? Okay." And then, of course, they lose again. It's like, and then, like, 3 years later, the British come back. Like, "Hey, Austria, I know you just lost the war again. No, England, I don't want to get involved again. Listen, I've got Russia involved, I've got Prussia involved, it can't go wrong, okay? And I'll give you £5 million. I'm not sure, what about £10 million? And that's how we won, and that's how we did politics in the Napoleonic Wars. You know what a pool shark is? No, I don't. I would assume it's a shark that lives in a pool. Yeah, 90% of the wars that the other countries declare. But then again, what Napoleon was good at was putting forward peacetime policies and demands that no sovereign country could agree to. And so... So it was either a choice between doing these demands, which was basically insane, or going to war. This is a good old-fashioned slaughter. I like this. Although the Prussians aren't particularly trustworthy in this time period, but the Prussians, you know, I think the Prussians sit on the fence about whether or not to join Napoleon. And then they backstab him. And then they backstab him a second time. And then they finally backstab him a final time. The Prussians were not the most trustworthy boys in the Napoleonic period. May lose to the north. Gladden may lose too many casualties here. And I've lost Wingo as well. I don't really understand why this is a minor defeat. Potentially, yeah. Potentially the enemy has got more time on objectives. Might be due to casualties, but it shouldn't be because we're smashing. We are Hulk smashing these guys. Come on, Gladden, you can win this. Alright, start turning this way. You beat the enemy artillery. My cavalry is still not in a good spot right now. Cavalry's been all over the place for the past, like, for most of this battle. Yeah, I think I saw that on Pool Sharks. I think I saw that on Better Call Saul. Where he scams people. They pretend to be bad for a bit. There's a scam I saw in Spain where you have this guy doing these, you know, the three cups, one bowl. And he'd have a load of insiders, and these insiders would always, it'd be pretty obvious where the bowl was. And they'd put 50 euros down, and they'd find the bowl, and then when a random person did it, he would use that trick to hide the ball and you'd lose 50 euros using that sleight of hand. And that was the scam. So of course it would look to the common observer that is an easy game, it's easy money, and it would trick these guys into spending money on it. But once a real person did it, of course out came the scam. Oh no, the British gave them, gave the guys money, and it was more like France was farming the European nations. Yeah, I think really a lot of France's wealth during the time period came from war reparations, from winning the battles. Yeah, so what the British would give money to the European powers, they'd go towards the French, and then the French would beat them and then take their money, take our money from them. And some clay, of course. Don't forget about the clay. And that just kept on going for about 15 years or so. Until you know what happens. Now Poupin gets smashed in Moscow. From Lee General Winter meme. Like imagine unironically caring about your logistics. Like, just walk to Moscow, boys. Some people argue that Napoleon made the mistake of leaving Moscow. Because earlier the Swedes had, I think, done the same, but they had stayed in Moscow. And in doing so, they had survived the winter. But I don't think it would have been possible for the French to stay in Moscow, because it would have been all burnt and destroyed at that stage. Oh, he was trying to get that decisive battle, wasn't he? I mean, Borodino, he almost had it, but he just couldn't pull it off. It just became a draw. Yeah, Russia used the old scorched earth meme. Yeah, like in World War II. They just retreated back. Well, they just retreated back, refused to give battle to the French, so they got deeper and deeper in. Then they used Cossacks to sort of raid the French army while destroying territory. And then, of course, once winter came, there was no food. The supply lines kept on getting harassed by Cossacks. And so the French had to just retreat back because there was no way they could stay. But I think what saved them is the Russians had quite an intelligent commander. I think it was Bagration. I believe it was Bagration. And he knew that you couldn't fight Napoleon. You just had to let logistics do the thing. And so Alexander, who was like the king at the time, or the Tsar, was like, we should have decisive battle. And Bagration was like, no, we shouldn't have decisive battle. And Alexander kept on saying, we need a fight. And Bagration was like, constantly trying to stop him being an idiot. And I think Borodino was a product of that, of like Alexander having a hissy fit and being like, no, I want my decisive battle now. It was a different time, like when people still cared about honor and it was dishonorable to run from the battles and things like that. Kutuzov also wants... it's Kutuzov, not Bagration. Sorry, it's been a while since I've read about Napoleonic history. I apologize for massacring that analogy. But the rest is right. It's my opinion. But I think the Napoleonic period is criminally underrated in strategy games. There should be more Napoleonic wars, more games based off Napoleonic period. Like, imagine a game like this set in a Napoleonic period. It'd be amazing. Okay, a little cav bug here. We've got some of the cav over there, some of the cav over here. At the moment Napoleon entered into Russia, the weather was really good, the winter came late and it was really bad, so Napoleon didn't get time to really make move to prevent a bad retreat. Yeah. And then it all went badly wrong from there. So it's the end of the day. Is there more troops coming? Or is it this? So it's nice that I can have my army reorganized. This is the closest we'll probably get to a Napoleonic Wars game for the foreseeable future. I mean, it's almost Napoleonic War, just with better cannon and better muskets. Like, imagine Ultimate General set in a Napoleonic War period. It'd be amazing. Or this game set in a Napoleonic War period. Oh, the Crimean War. See, I don't know a lot about the Crimean War. But it's an interesting one because it's one of the few times before like World War One where the French and the English all team up. Because, you know what, you son of a bitch, I'm in. And we all come in, piled in on the Russians. I'm getting the team back together. It's like that meme with like Arnold Schwarzenegger with the other guy, and he's like, ah, you son of a bitch, I'm in. And they both hold hands. And then we go and do like a charge with a light brigade and get blown up, and the French are laughing. It's like, oh, you're gonna regret that when in about 60 years' time. No, the French laugh. Yo. You weren't laughing at Verdun now, were you, boy? You weren't laughing when you kept on telling us to attack at the Somme. Like, why aren't you attacking? It's like, don't worry about it. The French will deal with it. Like, we need you to attack now, UK. It's like, oh, okay. All right. Let's get 200,000 boys together. We're going to go on a yeet run. We're all going to start walking in a line towards the enemy. Yeah, it's something I think there's a famous film about the Crimean War, about the Charles of Light Brigade. I think there's a French general that says it's very beautiful or something like that, but it's not war. Oh, an English one. Okay. Yeah, the French. Well, the French had a good run in the 1800s. They were pretty. You're doing pretty well. They were smashing the Austrians, and they were doing their colonialism. And then one Prussian boy gets an idea, and it all goes horribly wrong at Sedan. So you know, it all spins around. In fact, it's probably one of the few times that, you know, the Prussians actually siege Paris is the Franco-Prussian War. Whereas they never actually got to sieging Paris in the First World War. The French campaign, but you won it, and that's what counts. You won it. What, is Napoleon III? I think there's a funny story about Napoleon III. He tried to come back too early, so he was hanging around in England, and he got some boys together, and he landed in some French town and went straight to the gendarmerie or went straight to the local constabulary and says, "I'm the French Empire. March with me to take Paris." And they just arrested him. They just arrested him. Then he got deported back to England or something like that. And then later on he became emperor. Later on, he became emperor, and he had a good run, and then he got yeeted at Sedan, and he had to give up, where he had to capitulate. Yeah, Austria does not have a good time in the 1800s. Austria gets yeeted in Italy, then he gets yeeted in the Brothers' War. Really, Austria's And then suddenly they become friends with the Prussians, and then they become friends with the Italians, and the Italians backstab them. There's a saying here, you know, never trust the Italians in a war. Italy, it seems like we're at war. Would you mind honouring that triple alliance we have? I don't think so, bro. That Venice is looking rather tasty. I'm going to charge into the Isonzo about 12 times, lose, and then have to get surrounded and retreat. The Seven Years' War is very not often covered again. I know there's the Miracle Berlin or something like that, where the Russian emperor dies just as Berlin is about to get sieged or taken, and the new emperor is Paul or something like that, and he really likes the Prussians. And so he pieces out with Frederick the Great, and he carries on and wins the game. Well, not wins the game, but survives. I forgot what it was called. I think it was a Miracle Berlin or something like that. Yeah, 1600s, 1500s, 1400s, not very well covered in history, if I'm honest. Which is a pity, because it's an interesting period, the 1600s. And the 1700s as well. You know, the French were pretty on top, you know, for most of the 1200s, 1300s, 15. Well, actually, the 1500s, the French don't have a particularly good time. They get yeeted quite a bit by the Spanish because they've got all the Spanish gold, so they keep on winning. What was the battle? Because the Spanish king was Catholic, and he won his famous battle against the French. I forgot what it's called. It's not Valois. But anyway, it just keeps on slapping the French around until he runs out of money. And then, of course, the French get the revenge. Well, actually, the French, they actually become good friends afterwards. The French and the Spanish have a nice little romance for a while. Yeah, 1500s is not a good time period for the French. A lot of religious unrest. Okay. Little minor bug here. I've got to capture some victory points. Well, I wouldn't say best of friends. It's more like friends that are convenient. If I'm honest, the French have never really particularly liked us. And we've never particularly liked the French. But we've just sort of become allies out of necessity most of the time. You can even see it today. Like, you can see the Calais mayor just, like, refusing to, like, blockading Dover. Just out of malice. Yeah. We've mostly been allies out of necessity. Yeah, because of mutual enemies. Yeah, effectively mutual enemies is what it is. You know, the only reason we joined the French really in the First World War. I know we say it's out because of Belgium, but actually it's more to do with stopping Germany becoming too powerful. It's like, yeah, we don't want the Germans to become a European superpower. We've got to keep that balance of power, bro. And so we'll keep the French. We'll help the French for this. We'll help this French this one time, and then we'll go back to basics. And then World War II is just an extension of World War I with tanks. So yeah, exactly. It's about the balance of power. Ah, that's why. It appears to be a reinforcing enemy corps coming up behind me. Nanny? That's not good. Half my army is not where it's supposed to be. Well, we had a good run about keeping the balance of power. We did a pretty good job of it, the British. And then after the First World War, we were just like, yeah, we can't do this anymore. America, it's your job now. Like, time to fund some rebel dissidents in some third world countries. This can't go wrong. Yeah, a lot of people are saying that America's on its way out, but it's still up in the air. Like, it takes a while for empires to fall, and there's still time for the Americans to pull it back out and make the comeback. This is an interesting change in pace. Yeah, you had a good run. You know, as long as you don't implode and you go out gracefully. Yeah, China's pretty big right now, but China's always been fairly insular. Like, you got to remember historically, like, the Chinese were, like, even like during the Roman times, they were like a massive empire, but they mostly kept themselves, if you know what I mean. They're mostly just influenced with trade and things like that. They never really were like expansionist. So even if China does become a big boy, I reckon it'll be a passive sort of thing, like an economic superpower, rather than a military or territorial superpower. I mean, you could argue that China's a superpower right now because of its economic clout. But you never know. The Russians might gang up on it. The Russians, the Indians, and the Americans might go in for one last yeet attempt to stop China's growth. Well, I think you had sort of a Cold War under Trump, if I'm honest. You had sort of a Cold War sort of scenario with, like, embargoes of trade and that, but I think it's sort of stopped now because of the change in political landscape. Russia will never make a military move to the USA and the same with India. We also said that with the French, and look how that turned out. 1914. We're never going to help the French, and then next thing you know, we're in some trench somewhere in bloody Bourlon or whatever, having a bad time. It's all about convenience with these sorts of things. I have what read a bit about that China Sea stuff. I saw it on the news. It's a bit concerning. I think that is going to be a very interesting political powder keg there, because of course, if the Americans stand down, it's going to be a massive loss in face. But if they go to if they get into a pitched battle and they lose, that's just going to be devastating. That would just be like, it would be, oh no, it would be the equivalent of a famous battle where an empire just loses everything, like the Persians losing to Alexandria. It would be a big deal. Like, imagine if, I don't know, like during the Cold War, America backed down on Cuba and nuclear weapons in Cuba. It would be just a devastating to and it would mean that all the European nations would immediately start jumping ship. They'd be thinking, okay, who do I team up with now? I reckon the only way you could beat the Chinese in a war would be this, not, would be the same way you beat the Russians or the Japanese, is that you inflict enough casualties on the population that you've caused a revolution from within, or you use nuclear weapons. That's the only way I can see it, because if you try and fight a land war in China, it's just going to be mountains of human wave. It'd have to be like the revolution effect. Get a few Chinese dissidents, get them to form a revolution from within. And then, after enough casualties and war weariness, have your little October revolution. Yeah, you're right, Korea did turn to a stalemate. I think that was more just people just unwilling to. Go into another world war at that stage. I think didn't I didn't MacArthur want to use nukes? It's like, and MacArthur asked for nukes for the Korean War. But they weren't given to him. It was like, no, we're not using the nukes. That's why he got removed from command. Imagine if MacArthur just dropped a nuke on Korea. Like, the Americans were going to give nukes to the French in Vietnam. Like, hey, I see that you're losing in Bien Phu. How would you like a nuclear bomb? He's like, I think we'll pass on that, Uncle Sam. The problem is that, yeah, well, it wouldn't be difficult to reinvigorate national industry. As I said, it'd be more expensive, and then people would have to pay more. Like, businesses would have to pay more, and consumers would have to pay more for their products. But that's the problem right now, is that with China's like labor model, they can make what they can make things so cheaply. There's no economic incentive to build, like, to have industry locally. So unless you revert back to hardcore nationalism. See, see what held China. I think what did hold China back was its technological limitations. But I think they're quickly and rather rapidly, basically just overcoming it. You know, before you didn't. Well, before, I know it's going to be rather unfair, but when I was a kid, when we thought about, you know, when we thought about China, we thought about sweatshops and coal and basic industry. And now, when you look at China, there's a lot more tech there. You know, they've really, like, it's really impressive. It just goes to show what, you know, like, it's almost like, I don't want to sound like a communist, but you know, it's like, it's very impressive what they've done, what they've achieved. Like, imagine, like, over the course of 100 years, like, no, from 1945 and the fall of Japan, they have gone from an absolute WHO nation to a rival superpower. So what's that? 90 years? 80 years? How many other countries can get to that same scale in such a time? Oh yeah, Japan did rather well, but of course America did do a lot of funding for the Japanese after what happened. You know, there was a lot of help from the Americans, who may have felt a little bit sorry about the old, two drop shot. Oh, you don't speak about Japanese after 1940, fair one. Oh, Japan, 1860 did well. 1860 did very well. The Japanese really came into their own. Very interesting. Again, a very good success story. I have no idea why this battle is taking so long. I'm guessing there's even more Union troops down here, or this is what's left of them. I don't know what the Russians are up to. It's been a while since the old Russians have been on the news. We've been wandering around this battlefield all day. I really wouldn't know about any of the Navy stuff. Still, it is interesting. Nonetheless. Oh, Russia's been chilling. That's what Russia's been doing. Russia's been having a good old time. I watched a film actually on Amazon Prime it was a Russian, I think it was a Russian officer school, had a load of orphans in it, and it was 1941, and they were sent to defend, to buy time for the defences of Moscow. It was a very interesting, interesting film. I had English subtitles for it, but quite liked it. Wasn't a bad film. It was like an AT gunnery school, so you had like anti-tank guns, and you had and they had to defend this bridge, and they had this, like, the doctrine where the first shot of the tank, of the German tank that hit the parapet, they would withdraw, they'd keep on firing, and after the second shot, they'd retreat the anti-tank gun out of the parapet. And then once the tank had fired off the third shot, because it zeroed its shot, they'd put the anti-tank gun back into the parapet. So at that stage, after the third shot, they've zeroed in. I'll look for it. I'll look for it. I'll find that bad boy. But yeah, it was very interesting. Quite sad, actually, because they're all very young kids. Yeah, a lot of the young soldiers in that defense. I can't wait to for night time so I can actually reform this army and do stuff again. Because these armies have just been coming in piecemeal this entire time. Where are you going? Why do you keep on changing your orders? Oh yes, the great Russian Navy. The great Russian Navy. What's the meme? They were at war with Japan, and so they made a navy, and sent it from like the east side of Russia, to Japan. No, the west side of Russia, Japan. And along the way, they engaged with a British fisher boats, and just had general misfortune until they actually got to Japan. This has been an odd battle. I'm glad it's the end of the day, though. So I can actually get into the battle now. Oh, yeah, it's done with work. Nice, nice. That's as good, yeah. Oh, when you free, are you free this weekend? Because we can play a bit of Hell Let Loose. And almost done with my next YouTube video. Ah, nice. What's it on? Tell me the deets. Tell me the sweet, sweet deets. Ah, the Tiger Tank. Is that for War Thunder, isn't it? Yeah. War Thunder boy. I can never play the Tiger Tanks on War Thunder because you've got to like always be angled. Please don't tell me that the AI has decided to disappear. Come on, AI. Stop retreating from me. Stop refusing to give battle. Yeah. Yeah, I hear the Tiger's a bit overrated. I can't play it in War Thunder because I go into it thinking, ah, Krupp Steel, I can't wait to win. And then I just get penned through the driver's hatch. And it's like, ah. So maybe the media has lied to me. What you should do is do an ironic YouTube video where you pick this really awful tank and you pretend it's good. And you trick people into playing it. And then listen to the salt. Oh no, pick the worst tank in War Thunder. Like, this tank's really good. Highly recommend the grind for it. I'm trying to think of like the worst tank. Yeah, it'd be the French tanks, but like the French low tier tanks. Where on earth? Have the Union gone? Alright, I'm sick of this. I'm trying to do some capping. Where has all the Union gone? Stop running from me. I want to continue the campaign. Why have I got Union officers running through my lines? Why have I got Union High Command just wandering through my marching columns? Like, I've got General McDowell just like marching through. This is silly. This is a silly game. No wonder my orders keep on getting mixed up. McDowell's just skirmishing with his own army. Ah, oh, yeah, finally some engagement. Absolute nuisance. There's quite a lot of you as well. Where's the cannons? No, Lee. Yes, Lee. This has been a bizarre battle. German bias. I just can't wait for the Russian subs and World of Warships. That is going to scream Russian bias. They're probably like the only nation that can still dolphin dive. Yes, comrade, secret documents. The Russians have 200mm armies on their sub. They had the long range. Long range torpedoes. Did 2 million damage. So there you are. You've been making me waste all this time. You're gonna have to withdraw a little bit. If I lose this battle, I will not be happy. Slowest army ever. Slowest army EU. I'm a tad concerned about this. Why is the Union being intelligent for once? Why has it built a defensive line? You're not allowed to do that. Well, that's the center gone. How many casualties have you taken? You need to retreat. Am I actually going to lose this? Hope not. He does, he bullies me in War Thunder. It makes me feel less than when he does all the bombing runs and actually gets killed and I was getting yeeted out of existence. Yeah, I didn't realise the Panzer III was actually good until I played Tank Warfare Tunisia. I thought Lionel Panzer III was a meme-like tank and wasn't very good at all. And then it actually turns out to be a really good tank. Follow me surprised. So the reason why these guys are so slow is because they keep on picking up, because they're feuding, they keep on picking up their own, like, picking up cannons. That whenever they come across a captured cannon, they're like, ah, I'm going to take this now. Which is not too good. It means this takes ages to get anywhere. Yeah, because they played too much Hoi 4, that's why. It's like, oh, Hoi 4 light tank's garbage. If it's not a heavy tank, it ain't good. Oh, because this battle has gone on for so bloody long. Because the Union has refused to give me battle. Like, I'm just going to keep manoeuvring around you. Because no one uses light tanks in Hoi 4 because they're made to be garbage. Whereas hopefully with the new DLC they'll be a lot better. Like, I'm going to try and build a really quick, like, tank killer in the tank designer. Like, a really high piercing, really high hard attack. So when I play Bulgaria, I can be the anti-tank killer. But we'll see how balanced it is. What I'm scared of is it'll just end up being, like a cookie cutter build, like, yeah, you've got all these options, but there's only three things you can do to actually make a good tank. Alright, now we're in the victory zone. What are you doing? Stop, stop, stop. I'm probably going to go to bed because I've got work tomorrow, so I'll probably go to bed after a few more campaigns. But yeah, I wouldn't mind playing some more of you. Even on the weekend if you're free, or later on next week, because I've got Held at Loose installed, so we can play that. Finally. Yeah, Held at Loose would be fun. We could do a Held at Loose. I plan to play that either Saturday or Sunday. But if you are on, we could give that bad boy a go for a couple of hours. Played a new mod. I did watch Forsen play it, but I'm gonna be a bit honest. He's not very good at military those sort of games. Yeah, I was watching him play and thinking, I'm not sure that's how you're supposed to play the game. So, casualty figures: 23,000 Union, 7,400. So that 5,000 is about 10%. 5, 10, 15, 20. About 40% casualties for them. 4,000 is 10%. So about 18-19% casualties for me. Yeah, we could fill a squad up. No, I don't plan to be a squad lead. Too stressful. I'm just going to chill. Yay, Sergeant Dool. Where are we going, Sergeant Dool? I can't see the enemy. Are we facing the right way? Can't feel my legs, Lieutenant Dan. No, you love it. Don't pretend you don't. Alright, we won our first victory for Washington. That should keep attracting more boys to slaughter. The Army of Tennessee is running. And running and running. I wonder if the Missouri State Guard can get promoted. Not really. Can't be friends, yeah. We can't be friends unless we take jabs, exactly. It's not being rude, it's banter. Look at the handle of the bants, bro. You need to build a depot somewhere. I don't care where you build it, just build it somewhere. Or march up to secure that depot. Please, build a depot. No ways. It's no problem, comrade. We have all the time in the world. Why haven't you taken this depot yet? I'm gonna need you to take the objectives. Like, you are standing on top of it. Yeah, free Monday afternoon wouldn't be too bad. Ah, finally, the depot is taken. Sort of needed that. Well, it doesn't have to be all at once. We can. I'll be playing it throughout most of the week, I reckon. Especially if I finish this campaign off. So even if we don't run each other all at the same time, we can still play. This is a problem. I've got low morale. 8 brigades with a total of 10,000 men that are low morale. That'll be 30,000. Deployed to defend. Let's see if I win this. Probably not. Come on, RNG. You know you want to let me win. Who's sieging me? Oh. You get a Discord yet? No. No, I am not. Oh, I've made a Discord, but it's a really basic one. I think I've forgotten like, the password and that. But I'll work it out. Come on now, win me this. Or, here's a plan. Yeah, it's fine. We can use any. Or we can speak in chat, it doesn't matter. We can do whatever we want. I mean, you can use my Discord. I'm not fussed. We can use all the Discords. March over and save Lee, please. Western army's chilling over there, okay. Sort of running out of good guns as well. It's not good, yeah? Yeah, the big stream. Okay, run over here. Save the day, please. There we are. Haven't got time for the battle today. Yeah, I reckon so. So win this battle, save Lee, hang around Washington for a bit, and see what happens. So I got a good feeling. McDowell's had a bad time so far, so. Yes. So with Hell Let Loose, it's quite boring, so you may want to do some editing with that if you do upload to YouTube. Yeah, so for like War Thunder, I'll edit some of that and upload it to YouTube. But I won't edit, say, this, because this is part of the experience, so to speak. But I will probably edit out some parts of Hell Let Loose. So you don't see the walking around constantly. Like a meme. So I spent like 7 hours walking. Much fun was had. Same with War Thunder. So I spent 20 minutes hiding behind this rock. And then I got blown up by a plane. Riveting gameplay. Or, I don't know, I point blanked a tiger, but the gun bounced. Effort attacked. You know it's true. You know it's true. Getting some action in War Thunder is awful. If you're playing properly, if you're just being a meme, then you're just dying all the time. Oh, just got to know the maps. I don't need to know the maps. All I need to know is that see a building, see a road, see the enemy spawn, hide behind the building. Don't move and get some ambush kills. Yeah. I've seen some meme YouTube videos of like shells hitting the side of a tiger. It's like traveling around the armor and coming out the other side. Like the penetration in that game is bizarre. Oh, ghost shells. Yeah, the return of the ghost shells. Right now I'm using that Italian tank. The one with the two dual barrels on the top. It's not really a tank, it's more like a vehicle. It's more like a really quick car. And you only get like 5 shells per barrel. And so one ghost shell volley is already like 20% of your ammo supplied is down the drain. Yeah, the CV-33. Like, ah. Looks like so it's pretty and it's quite expensive shells as well. So you've got to pay for the ghost shells. Yeah, you know the boys I'm talking about. The boy. So enemy spawns there, I reckon. We're gonna hopefully get him in this bridge battle. Yeah, World of Tanks is a bit bruh. They've got what they're doing, what do you call it? They're doing like a legacy server right now where you play all the old World of Tanks. Which is quite interesting, but I haven't downloaded or I haven't given it a go. Never know if I run out of things to play, I'll go back to it. So we're rushing conscription now. With the aim to keep up with the Union's mass recruitment. But we will see. Yeah, the War Thunder is more like the lesser of two evils. I mean, a matchmaking, a World of Tanks, you get matchmaked as a tier 5. You'll get matchmaked with like a tier 8. And you can't pen it. You literally cannot pen the tank. So you're literally matchmaked with tanks you cannot pen. Like, it's a team game. Let's hunt the other tier 5s. Like, okay, so I've hunted all the tier 5s. What do I do if there's only a tier 8 left? Usually even premium armor, premium guns. Aye, but because the different shell types, you can meme in War Thunder. Like, you can HE as like a level 1 tier tank and maybe pen if the gauging gods smile upon you. Whereas that's not the case in... Occupied, lost, occupied. Okay, we've taken all the territory. So all we have lost is this one. Oh yeah, BR, yeah, the economy is ridiculous. Look, that's why I'm a pay pig, you see. I've got all the monies. So I can grind in the German tanks. Can you cross this river? I hope not. So here's enemy spawn point. Are they going to wait or are they going to come straight in? Yeah, they're probably going to wait. Okay. It's too late to start the engagement, so guess what we're doing? Captain Cheese. Yeah, but the grind for the aircraft is awful. And bombers are dead. Bombers as a vehicle is dead in the game now. I remember at least like in the old days, bombers could at least like take one pass. Now it's just like, I've just clipped your wing. Goodbye. Like you can't even play arcade with bombers because of how bad it is. Are you going to need to fix this yet? You're not done yet. I remember there's like the Japanese bomber, which is a meme. It's got like a massive 20mm cannon in the back. But the other, like, they're just not viable most of the time. No worries, have a good one, Dool. Enjoy some time at home. Yeah, the H6K Japanese bomber, that's the one. No worries. I'll probably be playing this one battle and then I'll head off myself. Gotta get my beddies in. You don't need to build anymore. You're good. I need you all to fire at long range. Have you sent that order? No, fire at long range. There you are, that's it. This should be a pretty easy battle. I've got a nice secure bit of ground. Might as well finish that. Yeah, and they've sent the artillery over first, so. I might even bring the artillery even further up as well. All right, Pelham, you're the boy. Any attempts on manoeuvring over here? Potentially. Don't know, I feel like the AI has been a bit more intelligent this time around, apart from that yeet of that the artillery, but that's because they couldn't end the orders soon enough. Probably just my opinion, man. I'm more happy to stay here. We can just enjoy. Alright, who's gonna have some fun? Bonham's gonna have some fun. Loring and Anderson. You guys are not gonna have any fun. No fun allowed. You need to stop and you need to get into cover. What a shame, Keys. Maybe I can't zoom in closer. It depends on the topography of the map. Sometimes I can get really close to like about here. But if it's a bit further downhill, I can't. It's a shame. You retreat, Anderson. So of course the intelligent thing would be a double crossing, which I think the AI is going to do. It can't really manoeuvre all the way down here. It's not really in its interest. And it can't really manoeuvre up here either. There's like no crossing, so actually really, we've got a really good position. And the artillery we have is 12-pound Napoleon, 14-pounder James, 12-pound Napoleon, a James rifle, and a James rifle. We can crack this up to a silky smooth fire speed. You know what? I like to live dangerously. Goodbye to your cannons. Yeah, sometimes the AI doesn't handle its cannons very well. But other times it does it really well, so it's all swings and roundabouts. The key issue is because they either have the one cannon per like division, which means that there'll always be a cannon on the flank, which actually makes it quite powerful, or they'll have cannons that's all the artillery into one division. And that makes them very vulnerable because they'll just march down their own route, and that often means disaster for them. Especially like now, like they were marching down, they probably would have given the order to retreat, but sadly, come on now. But sadly, they didn't have enough time. Yep, in terms of thinking from the AI. That's a good move, so it's attacking with infantry here. Well, with skirmishers here, and artillery and infantry up here. That's intelligent. That gets the thumbs up in terms of intelligent action 101. What's next in its what's next in the AI's arsenal? Sadly, they're all going to have a rather bad time. A lot of these battles are made so much easier if you get the right round early. Then it just becomes a case of a turkey shoot. So it really just depends on the capture points. But this is an easy win. They can't go anywhere, they're stuck. They're all stuck. I'm more than happy to stay here all day. Oh no 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 no, let's cancel our order. So boys, what's on my list of games for Strategy Sunday? Honestly, not a lot, so I probably will play Hell Let Loose on Sunday as well, because there's no real new missions out for Gates of Hell, and although I do want to go back to Fools of Glory. I think I really want to finish this, and then throughout the working week I want to play Fools of Glory, because it's a pretty chill game to play, very addictive though. Okay, we've got some cannons here. I may tell my cannons to switch to battery fire, as one of my viewers says. We shouldn't be able to cross that. If you cross that... Oh, I'm feeling mold right now. Come on over. Cavalry. On defense, the cavalry is best used as a reserve to move in if any holes are made. So if these guys rout, he can send the cavalry up. I'm gonna sit here all day. I've got a capture point advantage. And soon I'll have artillery advantage as well. Whoa, sunshine. You need to stop whatever you're doing. What are you doing? And then 10 speed, and we can wait. For some strange reason, I think some of my officers are giving orders when they shouldn't. I mean, it adds to the historical realism, I suppose, but I don't know why. Sending more skirmishers out, nothing I can't handle. Who's guarding the bridge? Etune and McKinney. Okay. Alright, what's the plan? So it looks like the AI is doing a partial offensive on the south. And maybe a partial offensive in the centre as well. Very small brigade, so not very big brigade for. Turkey shoot. It's a turkey shoot. Manouvre on north. It looks like they are trying to do a combined offensive. It looks like it's not working. Which I don't blame them, because again, this time period, frontline offensive didn't normally go very well. Yeah, look at that. This point blank wipeout. May have to withdraw you a little bit if we're extended. Alright, what's next on the master plan for the AI? Second wave? Okay, interesting. Defensive was a battle of morale, so generally the one which that got lower morale and lost. Yeah, fair one, like the charges and that. Although I did hear that the Americans were uncharacteristically more aggressive when it came to bayonet charges. So often they, whereas in European times, if you bayonet charged, often one side would withdraw after a skirmish, whereas the Americans, they would bayonet to the death. Which was quite a novelty from the European standpoint. Okay, so the AI tried a limited offensive, then withdrew. Okay, that makes sense. That's an intelligent thing they did. There's no point throwing all your troops away in this sort of battle. That makes sense. And they left behind a couple of cannons for me as well. Looks like a rear guard they've set up. During the Punic Wars, bayonet fight was really fierce and everyone tried to disengage. It was a tactic to take to fake a charge to force any brigade to get. Yeah, that's funny. Let's pretend you're charging. Oh, I'm coming for you. Oh, quick, everyone run away. I'm gonna charge you. I'm coming any second now. This was not. I know it was not a very impressive battle, but a very impressive logic from the AI. They moved forward, did a limited engagement. Once they realized the attacks failed, they withdrew and they left a reserve to defend the rear. I mean, yeah, you can say the cannons memed, but the reason why the cannons memed is because they were moving forward. They ran into my lines. The orders weren't given to retreat, and so they just ended up getting slaughtered. Maybe they could fix that a little bit and have the AI have a bit more self-preservation, especially if they're cannons. Like, ah, there's enemy cannons. There's enemy infantry. I should withdraw unless ordered not to. But, it's not that bad. And the beginning of the American Civil War, generals were really into Napoleonic mindset. Yeah, they were. What was it? They were doing the Jomanian idea. They had what Clausewitz and Jomini, and Jomini was all about you know Napoleonic tactics and fields of battle. So they were all very, very, very Napoleonic. The early and mid period for the American Civil War. Again, not a very decisive battle, but this should. Fingers crossed, liberate old Lee from his predicament. I should have 80,000 troops in Washington. Because Lee's got problems right now, and the problem is he's a bit war weary, he's a bit tired, he's a tired boy. Narrow victory at Chepasaki. Am I going down conscription? I am. Why am I going down civilian warships? I should be just going down conscription alone. 29 days, that's what I want to see. Alright, let's see what happens here. So it looks like Lee has been forced to retreat, but that's fine because the army of Shenandoah has moved in to resupply the supply lines. Saved the game. I'm going to build a supply line next time really close to our lines. Okay, so I've already saved the game, so I'm going to do a withdraw here, but just to give you a sit rep. So I'm going to end the day I'm going to go off the previous save to fight this battle. So I give you the strategic situation. So over in the west, we have withdrawn from Missouri because of the Great Missouri Bug. And we are going to incorporate the Army of Tennessee into the Missouri State Guard. And then we have the Department of the Ohio with 25,000 men. The Army of Indiana, 27,000 men. And Department of the West, so about 50, 60,000 men hovering around here. So I'm probably going to keep that size, maybe add another 10,000. And then the Western Army is going to move up into Kentucky and hopefully do some engagement. It's going to be a slow process, but I just want to attract Union armies to engage with me and not move into my territory. So that's why I want. That's why I'm going on the offensive. Got Washington 1861, we can see Lincoln crying, we're retreating, yeah, more or less. They're running away. So I think I've got the general idea for this campaign with a new patch. If you leave the AI and you play defensive, the AI will swarm the entire Confederacy. They'll just go everywhere. But it seems that they are scripted, or they've got priorities to run back to Washington if you take it or you threaten it. So if we want to save the rest of the Confederacy, we need to constantly threaten Washington or own it and constantly fight battles around Washington. So my strategy will be to build up these armies as much as I can at the Army of Shenandoah, Army of the Potomac, and in doing so, buy time and keep attention away from the west of the theater. So next campaign, we'll fight some more battles. Hopefully Lee will be able to return, but the key issue here is supply depots. I take Washington, there's no supply depots nearby. I've got to move forward even more to take more territory to get supply depots. So once we win this battle, hopefully against the Army of the Potomac, we can move forward some more, get that supply depot, hold it, bring up Lee, and just keep on fighting battles over Washington. That should keep the Union's death swarm over here, whereas the we can just sort of play passively or have a less of a hassle over here. Yeah, definitely. You can understand why the Union wants to preserve Washington, and it makes sense that, of course, if the Confederacy threatened Washington, they'd put more assets to protect Washington rather than just ignore it and just keep swarming, which makes sense. But that is what the plan is. Eventually move up the Army to West in piecemeal into Kentucky and keep on fighting defensive battles to keep hold of Washington for as long as possible. And the longer we keep Washington, the more national morale damage we do, and the less likelihood of them lobbing elsewhere and ignoring or using their superior numbers to overwhelm us. We'll eventually probably be a losing battle if we can't do any more damage, but fingers crossed it'll work. Yeah, unfortunately, I don't think I've got enough manpower to reach Philadelphia. You see, I would like to take Fredericton, Baltimore, and Annapolis, but because they've got so many armies here, what I'm concerned about is I'm going to have a limited manpower. So if I overextend, I've done this a few times, I've tried to extend to Baltimore, and a Union swarm just moves behind me and cuts off my supply lines. Also, my armies concentrated have more strength than they are dispersed. So if I keep hold of, say, around this area, I can make sure that most of my armies can march towards each other and reinforce. Whereas if I start moving up to Philadelphia, I'm going to start weakening myself. So in a perfect world, my perfect strategy would be to take Washington, Fredericton, Baltimore, and Annapolis. But if I can't do that, then it's just going to be a hard camp around Washington. Maybe if I get enough manpower, we can move up to Philadelphia. But it's something that's sort of something for the old campaigns. Now with the Union being so strong, you're playing a very vulnerable game, dispersing your troops. But we will see. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for watching. I will probably be playing more of this tomorrow. Maybe some Hell Let Loose, haven't decided yet. Still, a better campaign than last time. So, have a good one, and adieu.